It seems like every now and then Nintendo likes to get weird and publish something a little bit more mature than their family-friendly reputation often binds them to. I mean, one day I guess they threw up their arms and were like, sure, whatever, let's publish a horror game where you chop off the arms and heads of meaty flesh zombies in a Cthulhu-inspired hell mansion. And that was just the first time they published an M-rated game, and no, Conker doesn't count. That was Rare published, not Nintendo. Remember Geist? That thing was cool. You're possessing tanks and stuff. And then about 9 years later, they announced publishing rights to Bayonetta, and everybody's here thinking, oh, so this is the third M-rated game they've published now, but those people would only be half right. A number of years after Fatal Frame 3, Tecmo would team up with Nintendo for the fourth installment, moving the series from PlayStation to the Wii. Thing is, though, it never came out in North America. It was really close to being localized, but ultimately, the English version was cancelled. If it was given a Western release, this would have been the third M-rated game from Nintendo, though I guess a C from CERO is a 15 and up, which is sort of like between T and M, so who knows what the ESRB would have thought of it. In the end, the fourth Fatal Frame game ended up being exclusive to Japan, and it's since become that one weird game in the series that a lot of people don't know about. Nintendo wouldn't be the only one backing this thing's development, though. Suda51 and his team Grasshopper were brought on board to co-direct and co-develop the game. Around this time, Suda was best known for Killer7 and No More Heroes, and come to think of it, Killer7 is kind of similar to Fatal Frame. You've got a third and first person dynamic, having you look around for invisible enemies via scanning, and taking them out accordingly. It was surreal and kind of freaky too, making Suda not a bad choice for the Fatal Frame series. Interestingly enough, he didn't actually want to do it at first, saying that he didn't really like horror games, but after considering all of the cool ways they would have been able to implement the Wii's hardware, he then agreed to the proposition. Makoto Shibata would return as lead director and writer though. I guess Suda was just kind of there to pitch in ideas and help with development. Now, despite the game never officially being localized, there is a fan translation released only 2 years after the game came out. You can launch this via homebrewed apps, which still requires a copy of the game, so while installing these apps is probably legally gray, there's no piracy involved in using it. And besides, it is pretty freaking cool to be able to plug in a real copy of this thing into my Wii and then be able to play it in English, so a big shout out to the people who made this translation. Without you guys, I would not be playing this right now. People seem pretty dang split on this thing. I've had a lot of people tell me it's the first bad one, but I've seen equally as many people tell me that they quite liked it. I am gonna be expecting some weird motion control stuff, you know, you hate to see it, but I don't know, Suda51 co-writing and co-developing this thing sounds like a pretty fun recipe to me, so I guess we'll see. The plot starts off with two young girls visiting an island, Madoka and Misaki. Both of them grew up there, but they don't have any memory of their childhoods. All they remember is being one of the five girls that were kidnapped one night, three of which were found alive and two of which were announced dead. It's pretty clear immediately that Madoka doesn't really want to be there and that Misaki kind of dragged her there. The two get separated after like 2 seconds and Madoka goes missing soon after. After spending the prologue as Madoka, the game will then bounce between three different characters. Firstly, we have Misaki, exploring the island in hopes of learning about her past. Secondly, we have Ruka, the other surviving girl of the three. Her arrival on the island seems to be a bit later than Misaki and Madoka's, probably at least a day after. She heard that Misaki and Madoka have been seen on the island and she goes to investigate, also in hopes that she too can recollect her memories and figure out what exactly happened before the day they were kidnapped. And finally, we have Kirishima, a detective who comes to the island to investigate the murders of a man named Yu Hayabara. It's implied that each person's presence on the island is at a different point in time, but it's never clear on a specific time frame. Regardless though, since you bounce between these characters, the game kind of adopts a Tarantino-esque style of non-linear storytelling. Exploring the island will again consist of what you'd expect from a Fatal Frame game. You'll look around each room, finding notes and key items, solving minor puzzles, and of course taking photographs of spirits. It's the same song and dance we've come to recognize by now. Though, Fatal Frame 4 is the first game to make some major changes. Firstly, the fixed camera has been ditched in favor of a more modern over-the-shoulder camera. The game now plays like Resident Evil 4 did. It's that sort of tank controls that you don't really mind because the camera's glued to your back. The flashlight can be aimed up and down by tilting the Wii Remote up and down, and while it's okay, it's puzzling to me that they didn't implement pointing controls instead. Yeah, it's really weird. The game does not use the sensor bar at all for the flashlight. Instead, you aim it left and right by simply turning left and right, and up and down is handled via tilt. The combat also works fairly similarly. Again, you rotate the camera using the stick, and then you tilt up and down using the Wii remote, but now you're able to lock onto each ghost by using the Z button. I remember the Wii remake of 2 also did this, but there, that would only point you in the general direction. You still had to clunkily tilt the Wii remote to try and get the cursor to hover over them. But here it's like, no, once you're locked on, you're locked on. That cursor is glued right to them, and there's nothing more to it. This is way too easy. There's not much skill involved anymore. You're no longer trying to keep the cursor over the ghost to slowly charge up. No, now you just kinda hold the Z button and that's about it. Being a game with a great deal of aiming between the flashlight and the camera, you'd expect it to play like Silent Hill Shattered Memories or Metroid Prime 3 or something, aiming with the cursor and then moving the camera by aiming at the sides of the screen. It works great in those games, and I do think it would have worked really great here too. I could imagine maybe locking onto a general direction and then having to manually keep the cursor over them to charge up, but what they have here instead kind of defeats the whole challenge that Fatal Frame's combat was known for. Kirishima, on the other hand, takes a much different direction for the combat. Instead of having a camera obscura, he's instead got this turbo ghost murdering flashlight that obliterates anything in a wide radius. It's way more powerful, but to accommodate for that, you'll encounter ghosts in much larger numbers. This is kind of cool, actually. I do like them trying something new. It is sort of weird, but it does help add a little bit of variety to the gameplay, so I think it's a welcome addition. Like the prior games, you also have power-ups, but I never really felt the need to use them here because of how easy the combat is made by this lock-on system. I rarely even had to use the stronger film types either. The Type 7 was all I needed for most encounters because I was pretty much guaranteed to always land my shots without fail. Going back to the rules of Fatal Frame 2, the Type 7 film is once again infinite, with the other film types being limited only to what you find. That was something I did like a lot about too, so I am glad they went back to it. Now, while I did find the combat to be quite stripped down, I did actually really like the exploration. The way items are found was tweaked a little bit. Instead of just walking over to any big glowing blue orbs you see, you're now instead shown when an item is nearby, when the lamp at the lower right glows blue. It's sort of like a game of hot and cold. The closer you are, the brighter it'll light up, and then you'll have to shine your flashlight over it for it to appear, which will have you scanning the flashlight up and down over the environment. This is a really nice change that complements the new over-the-shoulder camera quite nicely. You have much more incentive to get a closer look at your surroundings, which is really good because they put a lot of work into the environments this time. Instead of your typical traditional Japanesey looking house, Fatal Frame 4 is the first in the series to have a more modern setting. The game takes place in a mental ward, of which is split into two main buildings, the hospital building and the building the patients would live in. And I can't lie, hospitals are a classic setting for horror games, so it was pretty cool to see Fatal Frame's take on it. Walking around and seeing all of these twisted devices that were once used by these doctors, it does a pretty good job of sparking that more sinister part of your imagination. The living quarters have a more westernized look to it, and to be honest, after spending 3 entire games in a row with a pretty samey look to it, this was kind of a breath of fresh air. And out of all the games so far, I'd say 4 probably has one of the better map designs. The place is super easy to navigate, and the corridors even all loop nicely, so it never takes too long to get to your destination. Though, like always, you can't run any faster than a light jog, so it's a good thing the map isn't too big this time. Also, if you mash the run button while holding up on the stick, you do this, and that's really funny. Seriously though, what is with the running speed in these games? After playing this series, James Sunderland feels like a damn race car. Keeping your bearings this time around is so easy, because each and every room couldn't be more unique. You walk in and there's just so much going on around you to take in and recognize. In Fatal Frame 4, room variety is key. Before, each room would be some sort of iteration of a traditional Japanese setting, but they really went nuts with this one. You've got art rooms, receptions, museum rooms, grandiose dining halls, and the rooms each patient would stay in has a unique flavor that matches the traits of the character in question. You know, out of all of the maps I've explored in this series so far, I have to admit, I think this is my favorite one. There's just so much more going on, and the variety made the map feel so consistently fresh and interesting. However, as far as Fatal Frame games go, this one is a little bit more straightforward than usual. They do that whole Luigi's Mansion thing, you know, where every time you get a key, they tell you exactly where the door is. Also, you know, that whole thing where you see a ghost walking in a certain direction to kind of, you know, like nudge you in the right direction, give you an idea of where you should be exploring. This game does that a lot. In fact, almost a little too much. I mean, after Fatal Frame 3's super aimless, what do I frickin' do backtracking Hell Nightmare Mansion, I did at least appreciate not having to lose my mind over not knowing where to go, but I do still think they went a little bit too far in solving that issue. It just feels a bit handholdy. Sometimes I felt like a dog on a leash, going only precisely where the game was telling me to. There is a good balance you can meet, which I think Fatal Frame 1 and 2 both did fine, and considering how well put together the map is this time, I think they could have made the progression a little bit less obvious. But I guess in the end, I would take this over not knowing where to go at all, like in 3. Which, you know, isn't the only thing they really reeled back on. The game's scares are just not good, and there's a number of reasons for that. Of course, when changing the camera to be over the shoulder, suddenly all of those carefully constructed environment scares can no longer work. You can't make those careful cuts while leaving the player in control. So, the solution? Well, you'd think they'd just trigger certain scares in controlled environments after leading the player to look in the right direction, right? Well, no. Instead, this game takes control away from the player to show them via short cutscenes instead. So many of them are just cheap jump scares too. You cut to a ghost and play a loud sound. Cut to a ghost, play a loud sound. Cut to a ghost, play a loud sound. It's a one-trick pony, you're just doing this over and over! I've always hated that, you know, like when it plays a loud sound, because I've always saw it as a sort of a horror equivalent of a laugh track. You can say something that's supposed to be funny and have confidence in it and just hope people find it funny, or you can tell people it's supposed to be funny by playing a laugh track, then they know they're supposed to laugh at it. It's practically the same thing. You're just telling your audience to be scared, telling them that, oh, this is a scary thing, you're supposed to find that scary, right? Big noise, boo, ah, right? So, did that ghost kid just say sup? So, not much, little man. How about you? Instead of those delicately and brilliantly crafted scares, they resort to the most effortless and borderline ineffective way of scaring the player. This shit is so easy to do, and after the first couple of them, it's like, okay, yep, you're doing that again. Alright, yep, there's another one. Okay, we get it.
Hey, Vsauce, Michael here.
The other big reason why these scares aren't that effective is because introducing something scary in a cutscene doesn't have the same sense of urgency that it would've if you were still in control when it happened. You don't have to worry about reacting to it because you're not playing the game at the moment. Example, the first monster you encounter in Silent Hill 2 is this weird thing, and you're given a good long look at it before you have to deal with it. You get cameras panning across it, you get a shot of James reacting, you see how he feels about it. I never really found this encounter very scary, because it gives you a moment to process it, see what your character thinks of it, lets you understand it, lets you think about it, and then you're in control. Then you have to deal with it. Now, compare that to the first encounter in Silent Hill 1. This thing comes crashing through the window, and you immediately have to decide what to do. Oh my god, what is this? What do I do? Oh lord, sweet holy Jesus Christ, don't kill me! What? How does this game work? What? There's this sensation of panic that can only arise when you have very little time to figure things out. Now, compare ghost encounters in Fatal Frame 1 to the ghost encounters in Fatal Frame 4. Here, you have to think quick, you don't have time to breathe, it's here and you gotta deal with it, no time to lose. But in Fatal Frame 4, most encounters are announced to you before you have to fight them. Smash zoom with a loud sound, as if to say, hey, look, a ghost, you gotta fight that now. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? Another good example, this is probably one of the best ones in modern horror games. Your first encounter with Mr. X in the Resident Evil 2 remake. There's no cutscene to introduce a guy. You don't get a good look at him. You don't have the cameras panning across him. There's no, like, we're building anticipation. No, you just see this hulking mass lift that helicopter. He comes underneath. You don't know what's going on. You don't know what that is, and you have to react to it immediately. Fatal Frame 4 just doesn't do that sort of thing well anymore, and it's a shame because I thought the ghosts in this game had some genuinely creepy designs. A lot of sunken black eyes obscured by hair and uncovered during an attack at a brief moment. It's like this shocking gaze unveiled to you right when you snap the photo. I feel like this was the first game to finally realize the potential of watching a photograph develop and you're just looking at this awful, horrible, creepy thing. That sort of thing the game did finally perfect, and it just kinda sucks to see the rest of the scares rely on jump scares. Oh, and of course, speaking of jump scares, Fatal Frame 4 introduced this really dumb thing where every time you pick up an item, you have to reach slowly for it, holding the A button to move your hand. Kind of like Heavy Rain style, because you can let go of the A button and keep pushing. You can do this, and that's pretty funny. The reason it does this is because there's a tiny chance that this ghost hand will come out of nowhere and grab you. It's just a dumb thing they put in to cheaply build anticipation, but it's so cheesy and dumb that it's really ineffective. They did at least try some interesting spooky things using the Wii's hardware, though, particularly with the speaker and the Wii Remote. Sometimes you'll receive a phone call to progress the story, and the voice will come out of the controller. It's a similar concept that calling on Wii tried doing as well, but here I feel like it's genuinely creepy. The voice delivery and the sound quality mix together really well. It's actually pretty cool. And defeating a ghost also has an interesting voice effect. After you snap that final picture, you'll hear their ghostly wail fade out, but the tail end of the sound clip will come out of the Wiimote. It gives off this surreal effect, like the voice is traveling from the television to your controller, as if, like, while being exercised, the ghost makes a last-ditch effort to try and escape the TV and attack the player before fading out of existence. It is actually pretty cool. Weirdly enough, battling ghosts no longer gives you experience points. Instead, you upgrade your camera with these crystals you find lying around the ward. It's sort of a weird change, but I actually did like it. Making what upgrades your gear tied to exploration only gives you more incentive to explore. And as always, you'll also find a bunch of notes and diary entries that get across the story, and I actually do really like how it was handled this time. Like the second game, I felt that all of the reading material actually contributed to a bigger picture. Everything comes together nicely, from the experiences of the doctors trying to cure an illness they don't understand, to details about the ritual that these five girls were involved in, to diary entries from yourself that you don't remember writing that give you an idea of what you were doing there as a child. And also, like, too, the notes are pretty well organized. It's usually pretty clear who wrote what, and seeing the ghosts of the people who wrote these things and recognizing their actions from what you've read is a really satisfying experience. And, like, I know this is always what they go for, but in the first and third games, I felt like they always bloated the story with a lot of detail I either didn't find that interesting or isn't that relevant to the overarching plot, and I get a lot of comments from people who do enjoy that sort of thing. Learning about the lore and the nuances of the mansion, even if it's not that important to the main plot. And I totally understand that, I really do. I'm speaking from a purely subjective point of view. It's just something that I'm not too interested in. If what I'm reading isn't that important, I feel it kind of clogs my focus on the story that I'm trying to digest. Basically, what I'm saying is I'm old and dumb and my brain's small and I prefer a more directly focused story, that's all. And Fatal Frame 4's story is more so what I'm looking for in that regard. So, you know what that means, it's time for that big ol' spoiler warning. I'll run down the story real quick, click here if you want nothing to do with that. So, as I've stated before, Madoka, Misaki, and Ruka were three of the five girls who were kidnapped a long time ago during an old ritual. And what would a Fatal Frame game be without a botched ritual? The Kagura Dance Ritual. Once every decade during the Lunar Eclipse, this dance is conducted to open a gate to the afterlife, which the people of the island believe to be through the moon. In doing this, they would be able to prevent the blooming, which is the final stage of a weird ghost curse disease that the people of the island fall victim to. This was called Luna Sendai Syndrome, and people suffering from it would essentially slowly lose their mind, which is why the people who had it were being treated at a mental ward. And lo and behold, you'll read lots and lots about doctors not being able to figure out how to treat the people who had it. That's because this illness is paranormal in nature. It doesn't follow the rules that most diseases do. I mean, the final stage of this thing has your face exploding into this awful, distorted, blurry mess. This is what they call blooming, as if the details of your face horrifically bloomed like a flower. It's a very Suda 51 concept. You can kind of see where his influence leaked into this game. Completely obsessed with finding a cure to this illness, one of these doctors kidnapped several children so he could conduct a dancing ritual of his own. Two rituals occurred at once that night, the usual public one and a secret underground one this doctor kidnapped people for. And of course, both rituals mysteriously fail. I don't know if it's ever outright stated why they failed, but I'd imagine conducting a second one without the permission of the people who actually know what they're doing probably conflicted with the proper one that was happening above at the surface. Simultaneously, each person taking part in the ritual suddenly fainted. Asakuya, the main dancer, fell into a 2-year coma, and all of the children, save for three lucky survivors, died of a heart attack on the spot. Sakia would come out of her coma 2 years later in full bloom, unfolding a cataclysm that killed everybody on the island. She'd then roam the island as an evil spirit until somebody could finally put a stop to her blooming. Ruka would be the one to end up finishing the ritual, playing this song she was taught by her mother, which was said to calm the moon's rage and end the blooming. Placing the mask of the lunar eclipse on Sakuya, she lifts the curse from the island. Sakuya, of course, is the game's final boss, and man, this is the easiest final boss in the series yet. She barely attacks you, and it really doesn't take many shots from your strongest of film to take her down. But no, that was too easy. Of course, that's not the real final boss. You ready for the real final boss? Alright, here goes. Yeah, it's a piano. You have to aim the cursor at the screen and play the correct notes with the correct timing, and if you mess up 3 times, you gotta fight Sakuya all over again to get another shot, which, of course, I mess up and she kills me immediately, and I have to climb this entire lighthouse all over again. Dude, I was so pissed off when this happened to me. But yeah, I guess that's sort of the gist of the plot. There is a lot more to it, of course, but covering it all would take way too long. Overall, I do think it is a pretty great plot. Unraveling it all was really fun to do, and the way all of the characters' experiences intertwine was handled quite well. I love the detective character especially. There's a point where you realize it makes no sense for him to be pursuing that doctor who kidnapped the children because that happened a long time ago, right? Well, it turns out that he too died back then. He was dead this whole time. Just a lonely spirit exploring the island and re-experiencing his memories. It was kind of a cool twist. Fatal Frame 4 only has one ending though, just like Fatal Frame 3 did, which again, it also has that alternate credit sequence you can unlock by beating this game on hard, which has these photographs that confirm all your favorite characters made it out alive and well. But man, what is up with that? The first two games had fully fledged multiple endings, but in 3 and 4, it's more like a simple addendum to the existing ending. This game also has a lot of replayability because of these unlockables. Like every game, you've got those unlockable costumes, which I don't always bring these up because I don't always find the costumes that interesting. All of them have this Yukata costume, which I guess is a staple this far into the series. 4's got some pretty great stuff though. Beating the game once will unlock a Luigi costume for Misaki. That's super great. It makes so much sense too. Like, why not Mario? Well, because Luigi's the one who explores haunted houses, so it makes too much sense. And if you collect over 200 entries in the spirit list, you can also unlock a Zero Suit Samus costume. The design of the back even glows in the dark. That is so sick. Though I do think it would have been funnier if Ruka was walking around in a full-on Various suit. Could you imagine the footsteps? That would have been freaking hilarious, but this is still pretty dang cool. Yeah, you know me, I love my silly costumes, and it's really cool seeing Nintendo lending their costumes to a game all the way back from 2008. This is a really commonplace thing nowadays, but back then you never saw this sort of thing, so it's all the more special to me because of that. There's also tons of these cursed dolls hidden throughout the game that you can photograph to unlock bonuses like costumes and extra power-ups for your camera. I think the Karotons are Metal Gear Solid 3, it's an identical concept. You find it tucked away and shoot at it to check it off the list. And while I do prefer the goofy Nintendo costumes, I did kinda like the one you unlock for Ruka at $20 because it kinda makes her look like Makoto from Persona 5. Interesting fact about the collectibles, while you only need 200 of the 233 spirits to unlock that Metroid costume, getting all of them unlocks an item that makes your camera always fully charged. A classic overpowered bonus for getting 100%, right? But the thing is, you actually can't get this because a number of the spirits are completely glitched. You take their photo and they just don't show up on the list. Oops. Well, I guess that just about wraps things up. That is Fatal Frame 4, and honestly, I didn't hate it. In fact, I think I would say that I quite liked it. It does try a lot of weird things that don't really work, but despite its flaws, there is a lot here that I found pretty interesting. The story particularly, I thought it was really great. Finally, I'd say we have something that's almost on par with the storytelling in the second game, and these environments were a joy to explore. They're so detailed and interesting, and the new way you find items gives you a great reason to look around. Though, of course, I'd be lying if I didn't say there were a number of shortcomings. The scares aren't very good, the combat is quite watered down, and the game did feel a bit too linear at times. I guess whether or not you really like this game will depend on what you value more in a Fatal Frame game, good combat and scares, or an interesting environment that's fun to explore. Personally for me, it's the latter, so despite the combat being butt-ass boring, I did really enjoy looking around and piecing together the story. It was also really interesting to see where all of the changes in the Wii remake of Fatal Frame 2 came from, which, you know, was expected, but it was still cool seeing all of it first firsthand. And it's also interesting seeing how all of these new mechanics and controls kind of work better in a game that was built for them, instead of tacking them onto a game that was not built with any of them in mind. I did not react well to the changes in 2's remake, but I think that's because I already played a better version of it beforehand. Once you're playing something original that was actually built around those mechanics, it starts to make a lot more sense. Man, Fatal Frame is a really weird series, you know? Like, it seems like every game going forward, they get better at some things, but they always get worse at other things. I don't think everybody's going to like Fatal Frame 4. It's probably one of the more flawed games in the series, but it's also one of the most interesting games in the series. It at least clicked with me more than 3 did, weirdly enough. Different strokes for different folks, I guess. If you never played this and you would like to, I would recommend it. You will have to import a copy, though, which isn't terrible. Cheap, but it is worth going out of your way to get it working if it sounds appealing to you. It is a really interesting game. Next up, we have a spin-off on 3DS, Spirit Camera. I remember I used to go to Best Buy and Toys R Us all the time, and I would see this there on the shelf every single time because nobody would buy it. So I'm really excited to finally see what this thing even is. So yeah, I guess I'll see you guys next time with Spirit Camera on 3DS.